Hello, hello, everybody. Andrea Myeski here with Dentalelle Tutoring, a topic that I don't think I have ever talked about on my YouTube channel. And somebody was asking me, actually a couple people were asking me questions about it the other day. So I don't know if they're all from the same office or what, but we are going to talk about contracts today. Now, full disclosure before we begin, I have never signed one, so I'm not talking from personal experience. I'm just talking about, I guess, why I would never sign one, for one thing. I'm not saying that contracts are a good thing or a bad thing. This is just simply my opinion, and I think every contract is different, and it depends on you, and it depends on your situation, because I do feel that contracts do protect you as the employee, but it more so protects the employer, which makes sense too, right? Because they do own a business. But there are good employers out there, and there's bad employers out there too. So that's where you have to be careful. I do understand contracts from a good employer's perspective, because they want to protect themselves. I'm a dental professional, but I have seen dental professionals out there that are not very good dental professionals, meaning they'll just simply not show up one day, or they'll decide to leave for the heck of it. They'll decide to ask for more pay, but then leave if they don't get it, putting the office in a bad situation. So in that case, if that happens to an office multiple times, then they probably will have their staff sign contracts. So that to me is not a bad thing, but it depends on what's in the contract. Okay. So that's what I more want to talk about, is what to look out for in a contract. And if you don't like it, how to kind of negotiate the terms. Okay. But again, I've never signed one, so I'm not talking from personal experience, just from what I've heard. Okay, so if you're right now in the negotiations of signing a contract, so this typically happens when a new owner comes into a practice, or new owners, or they've hired somebody new, or they bring in a consulting firm that all of a sudden says, oh, you don't have contracts, your staff should really sign one. Okay, so the first kind of red flag is if that happens, okay, fine. But if the entire staff doesn't have to sign a contract, that's a red flag to me. If they only get certain members to sign the contract, it could be because certain staff have been there for 20 years, so they don't have to sign it, but you've only been there 2 years or 4 years or 10 years and you have to sign it. That's a red flag to me. Okay. I would ask, why is not everybody signing a contract? Am I less valuable than somebody who has been here 30 years? It depends, right? And every contact for every staff member will likely be different depending on your role in the practice and how long you've been there. Makes sense, okay? But some red flags that I have heard of are contracts that tell you that if you do leave the office, you're not allowed to work at any other office in town, or you're not allowed to work in any other office within a certain area. That to me is a red flag, because why not? Why not? Okay, life happens. If the office becomes so unbearable that you don't want to work there, I don't see the problem in leaving. Maybe they hire some new staff that you just simply don't get along with. They change owners that you just simply don't get along with, or just life happens. You may move, okay, and then say, well, I'd prefer to not drive to work half an hour. I'd prefer to drive to work 5 hours. Or the office may change their hours. They could be open 9 to 9 in a year. And you're thinking, I can't, work with these hours. So you have to leave. So if you sign something saying that you cannot work out in town, if you leave the practice, imagine how awful that could be. But you sign a contract. So that's the point of having a contract, is to go with the contract. So I don't agree with that. Even not being able to work in a certain area, say, I don't know, within the same area, within 10 minutes, within 15 minutes. I don't know about you, but I live in Kitchener, Ontario, and there's a lot of offices within a small area. So if I was told that I couldn't do that, I wouldn't sign the contract because life happens. You never know what could happen. In some contracts, which I'm not saying is a bad thing, but I wouldn't sign it either. They may say that for you to leave the office, you have to give 3 months notice or 2 months notice. You know, that to me, I would not sign because I'll say it again, life happens. What if they hire in a bunch of new staff, which I have said earlier, and they just make your life a living hell, you know, pardon my language there. But 2 months is a long time to stick around because anything can happen in that 2 months. Let's say they totally decide to change their hours, or all of a sudden the office is really, really slow and you're working 10 hours a week. You may not be able to afford that. But if you sign something saying that you have to give 2 or 3 months notice, that's crazy. You might not be able to afford that. 2 weeks is totally acceptable, okay? Even 3 weeks, let's say. That to me is acceptable. But more than that, life happens. You know, I have been in situations where the office was amazing, okay? I've temped a lot now. And then just something happens where it just becomes unbearable, where they will just hire in a consulting firm. And then all of a sudden we have to work 9 to 9. We don't have a choice. We don't get a lunch, blah, blah, blah. I left right away. And because I was a temp, I didn't even have to give 2 weeks notice. But if you are hired on permanently part-time or permanently full-time, it is a nice idea to give 2 weeks notice. Okay. But this office, I just couldn't take it. I didn't tell them why I was leaving. I just simply said that something has come up and I will not be able to temp at your office anymore. Plain and simple, right? So it's nice to not have to give 2 or 3 months notice. Some other things that I've heard of are you have to sell a certain amount to stay employed there. So you might have to sell a certain amount of x-ray taking, fluoride, composite fillings, crowns, bridges, who knows. I would stay away from those offices too, because you may not think so now. You may think, oh, well, that's not going to affect me. You know, I'll just sell how I normally do. If I do not feel that the patient needs it, then I'm not going to worry about it. But you would be surprised. If you know that you can make more money selling certain things, all of a sudden you see dentistry completely different, okay? A filling where 6 months ago you may have said, well, yeah, they could use a crown, but you know what? It's still okay for it. By the looks of it, at least another 5 years, you should be fine. Where your opinion will all of a sudden change and you'll be saying, oh geez, that MO filling needs a crown, you know, and you're talking to the patient for half an hour saying how it needs a crown, yet it really doesn't need a crown, but you might be short on your rent that month, or you might want to buy yourself an extra expensive purse and then say, well, if I sell 2 crowns this month, I'll be able to do that because I get extra money for selling. So that is up to you. Everybody's different, but that's just not something that I would do either, because I want to focus on my patients. It's not my practice. So I just would like to focus on doing a good job for the patients and not necessarily selling. Let me think here. I've heard of contracts where a new owner comes in and you're being paid a certain amount per hour, but all of a sudden they want to change it to this amount per hour. And then in 3 months, you will get this amount and then this amount and then this amount. Okay. I would not sign that either, because if they don't want to pay you at the rate that you're making now, they're not very nice people, and they should appreciate the fact that this is why you get paid the amount you do. If they want to pay you more, awesome. But if they want to pay you less, don't accept it, because this is your rate because of your experience and the amount that you have worked there. So don't accept less. So I have heard of that before. I've heard of new owners coming into practice and the dental hygienist has been there for say 30 years. So they have a certain amount of holiday pay. They have a certain amount of sick days. They make a certain amount, you know, things like that. But they want to now treat them as a new employee because they are new owners. So they might make the same amount per hour, but now they might get a lot less sick days. They may be starting off as a new employee, meaning their holiday pay, their vacation days, they might not get the same amount until they have worked for this new employer for a certain amount of time. I would not sign that either. I would simply go somewhere else. But having that said, if you go somewhere else, you're starting new anyway. So it depends on how you want to look at things. But just things like that, I see as a red flag. Meaning, you know, if that's how they want to treat me, I'm not going to accept it. And I prefer to go somewhere else as a new employee and just have them, you know, see me as a fresh person, starting off fresh, you know, kind of along those lines. So I'd say those are the more common ones, but please comment below and let me know the situations that you may have come across, and then I will help you guys deal with that situation because I'm sure there's so many. I've probably left so many out, and there are good contracts out there too, okay? You might be asking why I don't sign any. It's just simply because I like to be able to make my own schedule. I don't know what will happen in a month, in 3 months, in 6 months. I don't know. Even if I love the office and I feel that I want to stay there, anything can happen. So if I sign a contract, then I'm, you know, legally bound to that office, where if I want to leave, I have to think, oh geez, well, let me look at the contract again and see what I signed. If I want to ask for more money at some point, oh, well, let me look at the contract again to see if I'm up for making more money, you know, or let me look at the contract again to see if I need to work a certain amount of you know, hours, if I'm entitled to this or that. So that's just kind of why I don't sign contracts, because I don't want to have to, you know. Again, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm not saying it's a good thing. I think that every office is different and every contract is different. So look at it before you sign it. Usually you have a certain amount of time before you do sign it, or, you know, have to sign it. You may have up to 2 years before you have to sign it. So think about that too. But if you guys have questions, please let me know. I am very happy to help, because this is an interesting topic for me. I like to talk about it, and I like to give people advice, because I have seen so many people sign a contract and then ask me or their lawyers how to get out of it. And that can be very expensive. So don't sign it. Learn before you sign it, if at all. And then you don't have to worry about, well, what happens now if you want to get out of it. So good luck. Have fun. And if you need anything, you just let me know.